It's good to see everybody here this morning. Looking forward to our time of worship together. Let's take our chorus books and turn to page number 4. We'll sing these 4 choruses here, all glorifying our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Page number 4, choruses 5, 6, 7, and 8.
He's the Savior of my soul, Jesus, my Lord. He's the Savior of my soul. He's the Savior of my soul. Jesus, Savior, Master, Redeemer. He's the Savior of my soul. He's the Savior of my soul. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us, that we should be called the sons of God, that we should be called the sons of God. He is Lord, He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Every hour of every day, and every moment, and in every way, I'm leaning on Jesus. He's the rock of my soul. I'm singing His praises wherever I go.
All right, Robert's going to come and read for us now.
Good morning. Good morning. Psalm 132, the reading of the Lord's Word. Lord, remember David in all his afflictions, how he swore unto the Lord and vowed unto the mighty God of Jacob, surely I will not come into the tabernacle of my house, nor go up into my bed. I will not give sleep to my eyes, or slumber to my eyelids, until I find out a place for the Lord, a habitation for the mighty God of Jacob. Lo, we heard of it at Ephrathah. We found it in the fields of the wood. We will go into his tabernacle. We will worship at his footstool. Arise, O Lord, into thy rest, thou and the ark of thy strength. Let thy priests be clothed with righteousness, and let thy saints shout for joy. For thy servant David's sake, turn not away the face of thine anointed. The Lord has sworn in truth unto David, he will not turn from it, but the fruit of thy body will I set upon thy throne. If thy children will keep my covenant and my testimony that I shall teach them, their children shall be also sit upon thy throne forevermore. For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his habitation. This is my rest forever. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless her provision. I will satisfy her poor with bread. I will also clothe her priests with salvation, and her saints shall shout and for joy. There will I make the horn of David to bud. I have ordained a lamp for my anointing. His enemies will I clothe with shame. Upon himself shall his crown flourish. Father God, we come before you now, and Lord, we thank you for the word, because thy word is good. Lord, we ask you to give us rest today in Christ. Lord, let us continue to look to Christ. Christ. He is our righteousness, our refuge. And Lord, we just thank you for this day. Be with Brother Ken as he delivers the word today. Open our eyes and ears that we may receive Christ. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Well, let's take our bulletins, and on the inside cover, we're going to sing this hymn to the tune of I Love Thy Kingdom, Lord.
Great God, we come to thee with thee, our Lord and King, to bow before thy sovereign throne and hear thy praises sing. May every worldly care be banished from our mind. May we thy word with profit hear, and peace and comfort find. Our strength will soon decrease, unless our souls be fed. We know our help, our joy and peace depend on living bread. So let our hearts be drawn to Jesus Christ our Lord. Find sweet redemption through his blood and feed upon his word.
That's quite a prayer when you realize what we just sang. Every worldly care be banished from our mind. May we thy word with profit hear. It's going to be through Christ alone. All right, Bob's here to read for us.
Good morning, Leviticus 16. And the Lord spake unto Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered before the Lord and died. And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat, which is upon the ark, did he die not. For I will appear in a cloud upon the mercy seat. Thus shall Aaron come into the holy place with a young bullock for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. And he shall put on the holy linen coat, and he shall have the linen breeches upon his flesh, and he shall be girded with a linen girdle, and with the linen mitre shall he be attired. These are holy garments. Therefore shall he wash his flesh in water, and so put them on. And he shall take of the congregation of the children of Israel two kids of the goats for a sin offering, and one ram for a burnt offering. And Aaron shall offer his bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make an atonement for himself and for his house. And he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell, an offering for a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him, and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. And Aaron shall bring the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and shall make an atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself. And he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put in the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, and he die not. And he shall take of the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it with his finger upon the mercy seat eastward, And before the mercy seat shall he sprinkle of the blood with his finger 7 times. Then shall he kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people, and bring his blood within the veil, and do that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. And he shall make an atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, and because of their transgressions and all their sins. So shall he do for the tabernacle of the congregation that remaineth among them in the midst of their uncleanness. And there shall be no man in the tabernacle of the congregation when he goeth in to make an atonement in the holy place, until he come out and have made an atonement for himself, for his household, and for the congregation of Israel. And he shall go out into the altar that is before the Lord, and make an atonement for it, and shall take of the blood of the bullock, and of the blood of the goat, and put it upon the horns of the altar round about. And he shall sprinkle of the blood upon it with his finger 7 times, and cleanse it, and hallow it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. And when he hath made an end of reconciling the holy place, and the tabernacle of the congregation, and the altar, he shall bring the live goat. Aaron shall lay both hands upon the head of the live goat, and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel, and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat. And he shall send him away by the hand of a fit man unto the wilderness. And the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities unto a land not inhabited. And he shall let go the goat in the wilderness. And Aaron shall come into the tabernacle of the congregation, and put off the linen garments which he had put on, which he went into the holy place, and shall leave them there. And he shall wash his flesh with water in the holy place, and put on his garments, and come forth, and offer his burnt offering, and the burnt offering of the people, and make an atonement for himself and for the people. And the fat of the sin offering shall he burn upon the altar. And he that it let go the scapegoat shall wash his clothes, bathe his flesh in water, and afterward come into the camp. And the bullock for the sin offering, and the goat for the sin offering, whose blood was brought in to make atonement in the holy place, shall one carry forth without the camp, and they shall burn in the fire of their skins, and their flesh, and their dung. And he that burneth them shall wash his clothes, and bathe in his flesh in water, and afterward he shall come into the camp. And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the 7th month, on the 10th day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls, and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country, or a stranger that is sojourneth among you. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you, to cleanse you, that ye may be clean of all your sins before the Lord. It shall be a Sabbath of rest unto you, excuse me, and shall afflict your souls by a statute forever. And the priest whom ye shall anoint, whom ye shall consecrate to minister in the priest's office in his father's stead, shall make the atonement, and shall put on the linen clothes, even the holy garments. And he shall make an atonement for the holy sanctuary. He shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of the congregation and for the altar, and shall make an atonement for the priest and for all the people of the congregation. And this shall be an everlasting statute unto you, to make an atonement for the children of Israel for all their sins once a year. And he did as the Lord commanded Moses. And we pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the scriptures that we read that you've given us, dear Lord, to point to Christ. Dear Lord, we praise you will be with Ken as he brings forth his message and discuss the mercy seat. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everywhere we read in scripture, we understand that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. But it has to be that blood that God has ordained, all a type and picture of Christ. We're going to sing about this, hymn number 210, Saved by the Blood of the Crucified One.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one, thou ransom some sin and the new word begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one.
Exodus chapter 25, verses 17 through 22. Thou shalt make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, and 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof. Thou shalt make 2 cherubims of gold. Of beaten work shalt thou make them, and the 2 ends of the mercy seat. Then make 1 cherub on the one end, and the other cherub on the other end. Even of the mercy seat shall you make the cherubims on the 2 ends thereof. And the cherubims shall stretch forth their wings on high, covering the mercy seat with their wings, and their faces shall look one to another. Toward the mercy seat shall the faces of the cherubims be. And thou shalt put the mercy seat above upon the ark, and in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee. And there I will meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubims which are upon the ark of the testimony, and of all things which I will give thee in the commandment unto the children of Israel. Father, you instructed Moses to build a mercy seat, that Christ is the seat of mercy and the throne of grace, and he shed his blood for our salvation. Be with Ken as he preaches from his passage, that we may all see Christ. In his name we pray.
Amen. Amen. All right, well, let's keep our place here in Exodus chapter 25. My text is verse 17 down to verse 22, and the title is simple, The Mercy Seat. Of all of the furniture that was placed in that tabernacle, it's all a type and picture of Christ, but there was none more vital and more essential than the mercy seat, because once a year, that's where, as Brother Bob read there in Leviticus 16, the high priest was to take that blood of the bullock and of the one of the goats and take and go and sprinkle it upon this mercy seat. And it was only to be once a year that they were enter into that veil. Aaron's sons learned a hard lesson when they sought to go in and offer strange fire. God struck them dead. So what is it that's so vital about this mercy seat? Well, we know it is because it's a picture of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, last time, in the preceding verses, we looked at the structure of what was called the Ark of the Covenant. This was a somewhat like a box that was actually 3 feet by 9 inches long. You can imagine that, and then 2 feet 3 inches wide and 2 feet 3 inches high. So when you think of the Ark of the Covenant, this lectern here is larger than the Ark of the Covenant would have been. But in that Ark of the Covenant, and that Ark of the Covenant was made of acacia wood, as we saw last time, that acacia tree, you see pictures out there in the wilderness, was actually a thorn bush. But the wood was solid, and the wood was durable. But I find even in that a type and picture of the Lord Jesus Christ, because where did thorns come from? They came from the curse. And even the acacia wood was a picture of that curse in the wilderness that Christ became in order that he might be that substitute for sinners. He didn't become a sinner, but he bore the curse, that crown of thorns that was placed upon his head. It was typical of what it was that he was doing there on the cross, laying down his life. And so we saw that last time in verses 10 and 11. And then in verse 16, we read that thou shalt put into the ark the testimony which I shall give thee. Here, when it speaks of the testimony, it's talking about the law. A copy of the law was to be taken and placed within this ark that was to be built. And you can see, therefore, the significance of this mercy seat that would cover the ark. If you look over with me briefly in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 4, there were actually three items that were put inside the Ark of the Covenant over which the mercy seat was placed. And those three items in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 4 were, first of all, a golden pot, it says there, which had the golden censer. This would have been the golden pot that had the manna in it. That manna that the Lord gave to feed the children of Israel during their days there in the wilderness. Well, that's a picture of Christ as well. You can't see any aspect of what we're studying here about these articles of the tabernacle that don't picture Christ. And it says, which had the golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded and the tables of the covenant. So when it's speaking there, well, the golden censer actually would have been the altar of incense, and then over top of the box, the Ark of the Covenant, was the, it says, overlaid round about with gold. That would have been the mercy seat, wherein then was the golden pot that had the manna, and Aaron's rod that budded. That represents the authority of Christ. And they questioned the authority of Aaron and Moses as the Lord's mediators, and God caused that his rod should bud. You think about a rod that was dead, and yet here out of it was brought life. Can you see how that's a type and picture of Christ as well, who was dead but made alive? And then you'll notice it says, and the tables of the covenant. So this would have been the tables of stone that God instructed Moses to make, on which were the Ten Commandments. And we're going to see here in just a little bit why it was that those tables were put into the Ark of the Covenant. But now we come to my text here in Exodus 25 and verse 17 to speak specifically of the mercy seat, because the entire altar was not the mercy seat. It had the altar, it had the Ark of the Covenant is what it's called. When you hear the word ark, it's not speaking of the boat like the ark, but it was a container that contained the testimonies of the covenant. And over top of that, that's what we read here in verse 17, and thou shalt make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, and 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof. So exactly to fit this particular ark of the covenant over which it was laid. And it says there that thou shalt make 2 cherubims of gold. The cherubims were angels that depict the very presence of God. I know that some might argue, well, the Lord said not to make a graven image of anything on earth or in heaven. And so they would ask then, is God not violating his own law when it comes to these cherubim being made of beaten work? They're of gold beaten work. Shalt thou make them in the 2 ends of the mercy seat? Well, I've always said that whatever God says is right. This was not something that was made by man or for man. This was made to the honor and glory of God himself. In fact, in that inner sanctuary, the holiest of holies, it was God alone who saw that. And the high priest once a year when he went in, it wasn't to bow down and worship these angels, but it was a symbol that God gave that was representative of the very presence of God. If you look in Psalm 104, so this was on the mercy seat as well. So we can say that this mercy seat represents the very presence of God, and the significance of it is in how sinners are to approach unto God. Yes, there was that Shekinah glory, the cloud of glory that hovered over this mercy seat, to signify to those that were outside looking that God was present. But inside, when we're talking about being taken into the very inner sanctuary of this tabernacle that represented the very presence of God, how lightly do people today treat coming into the presence of God? We hear people joking about it. They don't have any idea what it is to be in the presence of God. And here in Psalm 104, in verses 3 and 4, it speaks here of God being the creator of the earth, It speaks of him who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters, who maketh the clouds his chariot, who walketh upon the wings of the wind. And here it is, who maketh his angels, that word is the cherubim, it's in the plural, spirits, his ministers of flaming fire. This is what the writer of the Hebrews spoke of in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 7. But it represents the very presence of God. Why did he create these particular angels? It was to do his bidding. They're his ministers. And is described as a flaming fire. God's a consuming fire. And any that seek to approach unto him other than in the way that he has ordained will find nothing but a God of wrath. And so this was not a violation of God's law, but a representation rather of who God is and what it is to have his presence. In Isaiah chapter 6, this is what struck Isaiah in the year that Uzziah died, because remember, the Lord had prospered Uzziah, and for 40 years had blessed his rule and reign, and yet scriptures say he was lifted up in pride and determined one day to enter into this very inner sanctuary and lay his hands upon the altar, where it was clear that only the high priest once a year, and that not without blood. So just like Aaron's sons were struck dead, here we find Uzziah. And when it says there in Isaiah 6 and verse 1, the year that Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne. Uzziah was a good friend of Isaiah's. They had a good relationship all those years. While Uzziah was king, Isaiah was the prophet. And when Isaiah says here that in the year that Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. John over there in John 12 and verse 41 said that that one that he saw was none other than Christ. That those in Christ's day were denying was God in the flesh. But what did he see? He saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphim. So you've got the cherubim and you've got the seraphim. These are all different names given to the angels. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto the Lord and said, unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. That word glory means weight, the weight of his glory. So even there, Isaiah being given a view of God and of Christ in his presence, in the presence of these angels, what was their cry? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Not love, love, love. God is love, but his love is for his holiness. His love is for his justice. His love is for his son, and his love is for those that he has purposed to save through his son. Other than that, be ready to meet a God of holiness that can only condemn sinners apart from that proper mediator. But here, coming back to my text in Exodus chapter 25, the significance of this mercy seat, we just read that in Isaiah 6, and here in verse 20, the cherubim shall stretch forth their wings on high, covering the mercy seat with their wings, and their faces shall look one to another toward the mercy seat, and shall the faces of the cherubim be. And thou shalt put the mercy seat above upon the ark. We're talking about this one specific lid that was to lay upon the ark of the covenant. And what he says there is that in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee. Isn't it interesting that at this point that we're studying here, the law, the tables had not yet been given to Moses. Back here in chapter 24, he had simply said to Moses to come near to the Lord and to come up upon the mount with him. And so what we're reading here are the instructions, first of all, that the Lord was giving to Moses as to the furniture that was to be built. But the actual law itself, in other words, the tablets of the law, were not yet given. We're not going to read about that until all the way over in Exodus chapter 32, if you want to scoot forward. And it's allowed. Remember, I tell you, when you read the story, read ahead a little bit, then come back. Here it is. In Exodus chapter 32 and verse 15, it says there that Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides, on the one side and on the other were they written. It's interesting because normally when you see pictures of the tables of the law, you just think of one side having the Ten Commandments. But here it says that both their sides, on one side and on the other, were they written. And it says the tables were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God graven upon the tables. So it was God himself that wrote upon those tablets. You say, well, how did he do that? Well, he's the one that created the world and the universe. It's of no consequence for him to take and put writing on a stone. But as we know, that as Moses was coming down from that mountain and he heard the noise, it sounded like war in the camp and the people dancing around naked, that in verse 19, that he saw the calf which Aaron had made, a golden calf, and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hands and brake them beneath the mount. All of this is yet to come, and yet the Lord had already foreseen and foretold that these tables of stone yet to be written should be placed in this Ark of the Covenant, the testimony. You say, well, what happened after he broke the tables of stone? Well, if you read on ahead again, and it's allowed, you'll see there in Exodus chapter 34, and this is interesting here, because the Lord had already told him that that Ark of the Covenant is where those tables should be put. This time, however, in chapter 34 and verse 1, the Lord said unto Moses, hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first. So this time Moses chiseled. And again, I don't know what all he would have had in his hands to chisel these Ten Commandments on these stones. And he says, hew thee two stone tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables which thou breakest, and be ready in the morning. And come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. And no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flocks nor herds feed before that mount. And he, that is Moses, hewed two tables of stone like unto the first. And Moses rose up early in the morning and went up unto Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hand the two tables of stone. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and in truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children's children, unto the third and to the fourth generation. It reads on there. So these tables of stone were not to be kept in Moses' hand. That's why he broke it the first time. That was significant of how the law has been broken. But these tables then were to be placed within the Ark of the Covenant. Again, a picture of being put in Christ. Who is the law keeper? Why was it that Christ came? He didn't come to set aside the law. That, those tables of stone were to remain in that Ark of the Covenant all those years until such time as Christ himself should come and take that law and fulfill it and satisfy it to the honor and glory of God alone. That should have been a reminder then of their own unfaithfulness, but even as Moses said, there would be a prophet that the Lord would raise up like unto him who would come to hear him. So all of this is significant. Coming back here to my text in Exodus 25, that's what he told Moses to do. Thou shalt put the mercy seat above upon the ark, and in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee. Be those tables of stone. And there, here's the important thing, there will I meet thee. Yes, every part of that tabernacle is significant, but here especially, this Ark of the Covenant that was within the veil, the holiest of holies, but the mercy seat that stood above it would be where God would be pleased to meet with Moses and meet with the high priest when the high priest would come in. And he says specifically to Moses, I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat. See, this answers the question, how can God be just and justified? How can God be merciful to sinners such as we are? Even as we read with Moses coming down the mountain, God saying that he was a God of mercy, but not just a general mercy. Most people, the way they think is, well, God's love, and he loves everybody, so that means he must love me. That's their way of thinking, but that's not what the scriptures say. God is love. His love is in his Son, and in upon those that he has given to his Son. Christ in the garden thanked the Lord that the Lord had given him authority over all flesh to give eternal life unto as many as the Father had given him. So this is not some general mercy toward sinners. It's a specific mercy revealed in a specific way through a specific person, a specific sacrifice, that of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was there that he would commune with Moses above the mercy seat from between the two cherubim which are upon the Ark of the Testimony of all things which I will give thee in commandment unto the children of Israel. How vital then is that mercy seat? Over in Romans chapter 3, this word mercy, mercy seat, is translated in the New Testament as propitiation. It was a place of propitiation. It was a place of the satisfying of God's wrath or the turning away of wrath. And in Romans chapter 3 and verse 25, we find how this very same term is used with regard to the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. It says there in verse 23, and when you think of the broken law, that's what's described there in verse 23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Think about the glory of God there in that holiest of holies, his glory abiding above the mercy seat. Every one of us forfeited the right to enter into God's presence when Adam fell. This is not an ongoing trial. That's why the Lord chased Adam and Eve from the garden, put an angel there with a flaming sword, lest they should enter in and partake again of the tree of life. And it was to remain that way until Christ came, when he bore the sword of justice. That sword of justice that is represented there in the garden in Genesis fell upon the shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. And from that time forward, God could be merciful and show mercy unto those for whom Christ came. But as far as we're concerned, when it says there in verse 23 of Romans 3, all have sinned, you could translate that all did sin. When Adam fell, all did sin and fell short of the glory of God. So what's the remedy? Verse 24, being justified freely by his grace. That's almost redundant. When you say grace and you say free. But that's for us to know that it's all by grace. But it's through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now here's the word mercy in the New Testament. Whom God has set forth to be a propitiation. That word propitiation is the word mercy seat. When that sinner, that publican in the temple, was crying out, he beat his breast and dared not even look heavenward, God be merciful to me, the sinner. He was using this term mercy seat. He was crying unto God not to look upon him, but to look on the mercy seat and all that those sacrifices represented to that point. And when Christ came, it was then that he satisfied all that that mercy seat typified. That blood being sprinkled upon the mercy seat that we read about in Leviticus 16. And then it says, through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. When it says through faith in his blood, that's by God's Spirit what we look to. We look to that blood shed of the Lord Jesus Christ that was represented by all that blood that was sprinkled down through the years, every year, that day of atonement, upon that mercy seat, but now fulfilled in Christ. And through that, to declare God's righteousness, this is an interesting expression. When it says for the remission of sins that are past, that word remission does not mean the putting away of the sins of the past, but for the passing over of the sins that are past. See, some might argue and say, well, Christ had not yet died, so on what basis did God forgive the sins of those under the Old Testament? It was a forbearing. That's the word he uses there in the last part of the verse. Through the forbearance of God. The blood of bulls and goats didn't actually put away sin. But there was a passing over, and that's what that word remission is right there. The Passover. There was a passing over of those sins down through all those years up to a point. What's the point? When Christ should come and pay it, fulfill it. And that's what we read in verse 26. To declare, I say, at this time. What's he talking about at this time? Since the cross. His righteousness. Was God just in passing over the sins of his people there in the Old Testament? Yes, because he purposed that when Christ should come, he would actually take their sin debt, that horrible sin debt, and pay it and put it away. That he might be just. God doesn't just look the other way. And the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Any that believe in Jesus is because the Lord Jesus Christ has paid their debt. So that's the term that's used there in the New Testament. Christ our mercy seat. In fact, John over in 1 John chapter 2 uses this expression, propitiation, when he speaks of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ and that blood shed. He's speaking of Christ as being that mercy seat. When he says, my little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. There's no one that's a child of God, has the Spirit of God, is going to be thinking, well, Christ paid it all, so let's sin. Doesn't matter. No, my little children, these things write unto you, that ye sin not. That you not be given to that life and that sin for which Christ came and paid the sin debt. And I believe even more importantly there, when he says that ye sin not, as you read through the entire epistle of John, he's talking about a specific sin of ever turning away from Christ and thinking of following some other way. But if any man sin, that's in the context of little children. So if any one of the Lord's does sin, and we might understand that word if also with when, it can be translated when or since or if in scripture, but when any man sin, any that are the Lord's sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. So it goes right along with what we just read in Romans chapter 3. God is righteous to declare righteous those for whom Christ paid the sin debt. So that blood being sprinkled on the mercy seat in the Old Testament represented that blood which Christ should shed, not the blood of bulls and goats, but his own precious blood. And when it says there in verse 2, he is the propitiation. That's that word. He is the mercy seat. He is the satisfaction for our sins. That's where sin was put away, there at the cross. That's where God declared righteous those sinners for whom Christ died. Not before. There was a forbearing of God with the sins of his people because of those sacrifices in the Old Testament. But it was an atonement. That's why it's called the Day of an Atonement. That word atonement means a covering. Didn't actually put away sin, but it covered until Christ should come and put away that sin. But it says here, and not for ours only. In other words, not just for those to whom John was writing that were primarily of Jewish descent, but also for the sins of the whole world. That's where people say, ah, you see, there it is. It's for the whole world. But it's in the ethnic sense that he's writing. Not just for those who are little children in verse 1 among the Jews, but those that are God's children from among the Gentiles, wherever they may be found in the whole world. The one common and distinctive grace that they have is that Christ is that propitiation for their sin. So under the Old Testament, God was forbearing toward his elect by the covering of the law. That's what it represents. When you come back to my text here in Exodus 25, that lid was made of pure gold. That represents Christ's character as God, pure gold. And the blood shed, sprinkled upon that lid, represents his dying as a man. But as long as that law was there, it had to be covered. And that's why it was necessary that for God to be forgiving one more year, it was temporary, every year, this blood had to be shed upon that mercy seat. It was a reminder that apart from the shedding of blood, the wrath and curse of God abode upon them. What a beautiful type of the Lord Jesus Christ we see here then, that it was he that was that propitiation. If I could just sum up this particular message, there are five ways that Christ is the fulfillment of that mercy seat. First of all, he offered himself to his Father on behalf of each sinner that the Father gave him to save. That's how he's the mercy seat. In the very presence of the Father, he's not only the mercy seat, but he's that blood sprinkled on it. That's a picture of Christ. God's satisfaction with his Son. God said, when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. He saw the blood in the types and pictures of those animal sacrifices. But when Christ died, that's where he saw. That was the blood that satisfied in his death. Secondly, he's a fulfillment of the mercy seat in that he is the one by his death that has turned away the wrath of God from each and every one for whom he paid the sin debt. Stop, think about it. Here we say, am I the Lord's or am I not? If I am, how is it that I can ever enter into the presence of God as I do and am without him casting me off? Well, it's because there's that mercy seat, the Lord Jesus Christ. He bore that wrath. And that blood that sprinkled upon the mercy seat in the Old Testament was a demonstration that blood had been shed. There had to be an animal that died. It was the shedding of the blood unto death that was what was required of God. And Christ has borne it away. Thirdly, he's that mercy seat in that he has cleansed his people from all their sin. Canceled completely and forever the debt. That's an amazing thing when you stop and think about it. And fourthly, he has not only, stop and think about this a minute, he has not only nullified the sin, but he has taken away its power to condemn. That's what we just read in 1 John chapter 2. We have an advocate with the Father. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He's seated in the heavenlies where he ever lives to intercede. He's that mercy seat in the heavens. But when we sin, he's not leaning over to his Father and saying, okay, well, I got that covered too. Please don't get mad. Don't get upset. No, his presence there as the mercy seat, that blood already having been shed, not only has it taken away the sin, but it's power to condemn. But fifthly, think about the mercy seat being the very presence of God. What it is now for us to be able to enter into God's presence. Completely, that veil has been rent in twain through the flesh of Christ. And it's Christ then that brings us into the presence of God. How blameless and holy and accepted in the beloved. Not just acceptable, but accepted in the beloved. What a precious truth that is. Christ, our mercy seat. Take our hymn books, and we're going to sing 351 in our hymn book. We sang last week 355, which would be a great hymn as well. Every stormy wind that blows, there is that blood-bought mercy seat. Let's sing 351. We'll stand and sing this together. Near the cross. Jesus, keep me near the cross.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning star sheds its beams around me. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find things before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadows o'er me. In the cross, may my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross I'll watch and wait, hoping, trusting ever, till I reach the golden strand just beyond the river. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river.
We take our guidance from God's word. That's always vital when it comes to how we worship and what we do. And the Lord's table, just like that Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat, which was vital as far as the worship of God there in the Old Testament. For us, Christ, what that mercy seat represented, and his shed blood is vital in our consideration of how it is we approach unto God. And so in Mark 14, what's called here the Last Supper, all those years that Passover had been celebrated, now it came down to this one. It says the first day of unleavened bread. That entire week was to be the feast of unleavened bread, and in the middle of the week was when the Passover was killed. Everything with precision, all according to the law. It says when they killed the Passover, his disciples said unto him, "Where wilt thou that we go and prepare that thou mayest eat the Passover?" Christ didn't eat the Passover because of any need himself for forgiveness of sin. He had none. He was the Passover lamb. But he ate it in fulfillment of the law and all that was written of him. But now came that time where he would give this new instruction to his disciples, which is what we're about right now. We're not celebrating a Passover meal here. Christ has already fulfilled it, but it's the Lord's table. And in our partaking with these two elements, very simple, the unleavened bread, which represents his sinlessness, and then the cup of wine, which represents his shed blood for sin. That's it. Nothing more is to be added were taken from it. But here specifically for this Passover, it says in verse 13, he sendeth forth two of his disciples. Why two? Well, the scriptures say that let every truth be established in the mouth of two or three witnesses. Here was about to take place something that all those years pointed to, and now would be the time. And so he sent two of his disciples and saith unto them, I like to think of the two witnesses of Scripture, Old and New Testament, all testify who he is and why he came, what he accomplished. But he said, go ye into the city, and there shall meet you a man bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him. I mentioned to you before that it was not typical to see the men bearing the water, the women did primarily, but here was a man, a servant, and they were to follow him. And wheresoever he shall go in, say ye to the good man of the house. I mentioned before that that word good in English is a derivative of the word God. So
So say ye to God's man of the house. Here was one, it would seem, that was the Lord's, for whom he would pay the debt, upon whom God's favor was already in his grace and mercy. And say to him, the master saith. I'll tell you, any that are Lord's, that's all they need to hear. A word from the Lord. Where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? He clearly knew the Lord. And what a blessing for him that the Lord should choose his house and cause that it be there that he would celebrate this Passover with his disciples. If the Lord has taught any one of us, do you consider how great that blessing is, that the Lord has set his favor upon you in your house? And he will show you a large upper room, furnished and prepared. I love that. What we're about here is celebrating what has already been furnished and prepared by God himself, ordained for our good and his glory. He says, there, make ready for us. And his disciples went forth and came to the city and found as he had said unto them. It shouldn't surprise us that here's the Lord who ordains all things, that this man, even going out at that time, bearing a pitcher of water, and then going to the house, that they find it exactly as God had said. He ordains all things. And they made ready the Passover. And in the evening, he cometh with the 12. And as he sat and did eat, here in verse 18, he's talking about eating the Passover. Jesus said, verily I say unto you, one of you which eateth with me shall betray me. There were many that ate the Passover feast in the Old Testament that perished, not seeing the significance of it. And here was one of theirs. We know who it was. It was Judas Iscariot, who had been with the Lord those 3 years, and yet was not the Lord's. One of you which eateth with me shall betray me. And they began to be sorrowful, to say unto him one by one, Is it I? And another said, is it I? God forbid that it should be one of us that should betray him, the Son of God. We know that that's why he went to the cross, was to pay the sin debt of sinners such as we are that have rebelled and have betrayed him. And yet, it was not for everybody that he went and bore that debt. There are those that are his, and there are those that aren't. And he answered and said unto them, it is one of the 12 that dippeth with me in the dish. Again, this is still the Passover meal. Taking bread and the sop and dipping it in there and partaking and eating. And the Son of Man indeed goeth as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Good were it for that man if he had never been born. I know some people want to criticize our Lord here and say, well, if Judas had already been ordained as the son of perdition, then what could he do? Well, here's where we see the mysterious working of God's sovereignty in accomplishing his will. But at the same time, he wasn't forcing Judas to do what he did. This was in Judas's will, just like those that crucified our Lord cried out, crucify him, crucify him. In doing that, they were doing their will. They would not be stopped. And at the same time, they were perfectly accomplishing the will of God the Father, delivering up the Lamb of God. I believe at that time, you read, particularly in John, was a time when the Lord said to him, whatever you do, do quickly. He got up and left. The others that were around the table thought he was just going out to give alms to the poor, which is what they did during that time. So anything outwardly did not discover Judas to them as being the betrayer. But the Lord knew. And so here now, verse 22, and I say that because this that we're about to do is for those for whom Christ paid the debt. It's the Lord's table. And as they did eat, the same Passover bread, that unleavened bread Jesus took and blessed and broke it and gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. Now, there was Christ right there in their presence, so they weren't thinking, as some have made this to be, some transubstantiation, they call it, somehow the bread being actually literally transformed into Christ's body. He was right there. They could see him when he said, this is my body. He's talking about it representing his body. And that's why it's important, not just any bread will do. I heard a preacher say that one time. Well, if you haven't got unleavened bread, just go down and buy a loaf of bread at the store. It'll do. You know? Had to be unleavened without sin and roast with fire. I love about what we see here, what we hold in our hand. It's got the marks of the flame on it. That's what it represents, Christ and his body delivered up. And then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. Over time, for hygiene purposes, we've poured this wine into individual cups to be able to give to each one, but back here in Christ's day, it was one cup. He took that cup and passed it around. And each one took and drank of that cup, being wine. It's probably hygienic anyway, but in our day, people get a little bit unsettled sometimes by those things. But let's don't get lost in the idea, well, we got our individual cup and it was one cup. It is one cup. This is all poured out of one cup for us, and he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, this is my blood, again, what it represents of the New Testament. It's not the blood of bulls and goats of the Old Testament. This is the blood of Christ that it represents of the New Testament, which is shed for many, not everybody, many. Consider a privilege even for us, if we're objects of God's grace, then we should be able to partake and remember him. Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until the day, that day, that I drink it new in the kingdom of God. That's not a sweet by and by. When he rose from the grave, his kingdom was established. And he rose on high, and where he ever lives to rule and to reign. Even now, he's partaking his presence with us. It's not in the bread. It's not in the cup. He's represent his personal work, but it's in his very spirit being with his people where he's present. And he drinks now. He's with his people. Gracious Father, I thank you for your word, the clarity of it, instruction as to why we do what we do. Confidence is not in the bread or the cup, but in the one that it represents. These represent your blessed Son. I thank you for his sacrifice and his shed blood, whereby we are accepted in him. So as we partake, may our thoughts be toward him and toward you with thankfulness and praise for all of great work that Christ has accomplished for sinners such as we are. We give you the praise in his precious name. Amen. All right, let's take our hymn books, turn to hymn number 224. We'll stand and sing this hymn together, and then we'll be dismissed. 224, I know not what I believe, but whom I have believed. 224.
Yeah.
him against that day. I know not how did saving grace to me he did impart, nor how believing in his word brought peace within my heart. But I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. I know not how the Spirit moves convincing men of sin, revealing Jesus through the word, creating faith in him. I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. I know not one good Lord it may be reserved for me. Of weary ways on golden days before his face I see. But I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know not when my Lord may come at night or noonday fair, nor if I walk a pair with him or meet him in the air. But I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day.
Amen. All right.
We'll be dismissed before the next time. God bless.